opportunity to fly the Cub Crafters Carbon Cub SS.
The Super Sport.
Super Sport.
180 horsepower of Super Sport.
Lycoming. Not Rotax, Lycoming.
Lycoming. Well, not even Lycoming, actually. It's sort of their own thing, I guess.
That has to be, they have to build it in actual fact in order to do what they're trying to do in the light sport category. Right.
So they're using the guts of and then making their own modification to it. But you know, when you first, well, it's on the left-hand side, when you first move that throttle forward, man, you get an immediate rush from that thing, and I don't mean just a physical rush. It's an actual rush forward, and the tail comes up, virtually on its own. I don't think if I moved the stick forward much, I hardly was aware of it. And then you better start pulling back pretty soon because it's ready to fly. Yeah.
I tried to do a three-point. I tried to do it with the stick back, and then I had the stick basically back in my gut, and that sucker still lifted the tail, and then it no sooner lifted the tail, and it was airborne. I mean, the wheels didn't turn once the tail was
out. Yeah, it's really fast. So somebody else observed, wow, in an environment where you've got, let's say, mission work in South America or whatever, where you've got little tiny strips and they're down in the trees or whatever, it'd be quite an exceptional machine for that. Now, the mission would have to have a pretty good benefactor.
Yeah, dollars and cents.
Because the airplane is, it's beautifully finished. Hardware pieces on it are gorgeous looking. The interior with all that carbon fiber is really very interesting. The big engine and all the rest of it. But you've got to have a budget to afford that airplane.
But that aside, when you look at the airplane basically does everything that anybody as a bush pilot would want to do, and then some.
Yep, and then some. And comfortably so.
Yes.
If this is not some Spartan, uncomfortable, at least now, I sat in the front seat, you sat in the back seat, and you indicated to me there's a little difference. In,
the front seat
was quite comfortable, fully supported, padded, solid, like you'd expect.
I'm a trainer. I want to fly as an instructor would fly. How am I, and you have to remember, as an instructor, you're not flying that airplane as a student for an hour and a half, and then you're out. As an instructor, in order to make your living at it, you're in there.
You're doing some hours.
You know, you're getting out every hour to stretch your legs and do whatever, but you're in that for 4 or 5 hours. The seat is a swing seat, and unfortunately for me...
Now, swing seat, you mean fabric.
It was a fabric seat, and it's... I guess the support isn't there the way that I would have thought.
It kind of moves around.
It moves around. And
I mean, not only the back is fabric, but you said the actual seat itself moves around.
Moves around in like just like you're doing a hammock type. That's what it felt like initially.
So when you're pushing on a pedal.
Yeah, and that was a problem. The seat is adjustable. I didn't realize, and the pilot hadn't adjusted it prior to me getting in. And he's taller than I am. Well, he must be, 6 feet, I would think.
Yeah, somewhat taller.
Yeah. I'm 5'6", a little short on the legs. And I've got some back problems, and I'm at the full extension to try to work the pedals, but as soon as you try to push on the pedals,
you push the seat back.
It feels like you're pushing the seat back. So for me, I couldn't have flown that airplane hour after hour without having that seat come quite a bit forward.
Now, it is adjustable, but only from the ground, is that it?
Yeah, there was no indication to me that I could adjust it when I was flying it, because I'm presuming that's what we would have done and made me more comfortable.
Yeah, so had you, was this your airplane and you were doing training in it, you maybe could have put some cushions or done some other things, adjusted the seats, which you'd have to make it fitted to you.
Yeah.
And in this case, we were just hopping in right after the other guy flew.
Now, again, as I mentioned, I had an accident about 5 years ago at rear end, and I really hurt my back. I'd screwed up my back years ago, and I'd gotten back from it, and I was feeling pretty good. But this 5 years ago, to get in and out of this airplane in the rear seat, if it would be a little lower for me rather than to step over that thing, if the door...
You've got to get over the door to get in.
And unfortunately, with the way that you have to get into the back seat, it's like getting in an old cup where you really have to sort of... and then pull yourself in. Once you're in there, it's not a problem. You're comfortable, but...
Now, when I got in with Ben Redman, is the name of the fellow who gave us the checkout. He flew in the back seat with me, in the front seat with you. And very confident in the airplane, and obviously quite at home in the Carbon Cub Super Sport. But Ben said, I was kind of going, well, the entry technique, and he said, well, just get in it like a cub. By which I, in turn, I figured he meant, well, sit on the door sill, which when you fold the door down, it's pretty wide, I don't know, 4 or 5 inches. Yeah, so yeah, it's a pop yourself up on the tire. There's a little step there as well. Sort of sit on the frame and then ease yourself in. But that's to the front seat, which is roughly the same height as the door sill. And there's a couple of steel structures there. So that was pretty easy. And then just pull your legs in afterward. It's pretty easy in the front. I didn't even try getting in the back. A little more challenging.
It was, for me, again, you have to remember, I would consider myself physically disabled. Not to the point where I can't move around. But to get in and out of an airplane like that, it was a little bit more challenging than...
In the rear seat,
in the rear seat. Now, once I got in there, like I say, the straps, I just did the lap belt mm-hmm. on. I don't like flying with shoulder straps. The control systems, as far as the stick position was fine. Rudder pedals, that's to say, the only problem was I was at full extension. Still able to operate them, but I was at full extension, and it was...
Legs fully stretched out.
Fully stretched out, and I'm really flying with my toes. Uh-huh. That's where I'm flying. The performance on this...
Are there toe brakes in the back as well?
Again, I didn't use any of the brakes at all, Dan.
But they're there?
I cannot.
I didn't even notice that myself. There definitely are toe brakes in the front.
Yeah.
And they're tilt forward.
Yeah. I would imagine with him as flying it from the back seat, he would have had control, but I can't honestly say. I didn't use the toe brakes.
Well, it had to be. Well, no, I don't know that, because he taxied out initially. And when he was seated in the back, let's see what you say as well. He said he had the fishtail, common technique, because he could not see over the nose. Yeah. From the front seat,
no,
and I'm just of average height, so I'm not a particularly tall guy at all. No problem, especially with the cowls. They've got kind of a shapely cowl up there to allow for the right cooling. And in the low points of those cowls, I could easily see the center line of the taxiway without any strain. So I could taxi just straight.
Short asked me, I was really looking out the side, doing a little bit of fishtailing. And I was using more of the side vertical eyeballing than it was anything. Like I was positioning.
Just looking down at the edge of the runway.
Yeah, edge of the runway and being able to taxi that way.
Right.
If there had been something in front of me, I couldn't have seen it. But
you'd have had to kind of wildly fish, not wildly fishtail, but you'd have had to fishtail liberally in order to really see what's ahead of you.
Now the only...
But you wouldn't normally fly that, of course, if you're with a student and you're not sure what the student is seeing or how well they're observing, you'd have to do that. So from an instructional standpoint, it's an extra challenge. But normally if you flew the airplane, you'd fly it from the front.
Yeah, if you were a student or anything else, or just on soloing yourself.
Or just Joe, owner of an airplane. Hey, I like this airplane, I want to have one. I'm going to fly from the front all the time. And if I take somebody, they'll go in the back.
Yeah. Now, again, this aircraft, if it was set up for a training environment, you would want to have some instrumentation in the rear.
Yeah, you had none back there,
none back there. And the only way that I could have seen anything on the dash was have the pilot move over and see. And again, as an upright pilot, this is what we were doing coming in. Somebody was quoting me numbers. Somebody was moving aside. So I said, no, I'm just going to fly it the way that I feel comfortable.
He did it all by feel.
And I did it all by feel.
And this airplane seemed to work out.
Yeah, this airplane flies. You can stall. Dan, I had this thing all the way back in my gut. And it just, a little bit, but it, you know.
Yeah, you couldn't see the numbers from the back. And I trust the in-flight audio came through. But we were seeing numbers. He did them first, then I did them as well. You're down at 30 or below. Now, this is miles per hour, and it's indicated. And at those speeds, airspeed indicators are notoriously error-prone. But still, the point was, it was very, very slow. And even when I got a little more aggressive about it and really kind of pulled the nose, I didn't do a real radical one, but I pulled the nose up generally, and I had to stick all full way back and idle thrust. And it kind of just sort of slowly went down. The slight easing of the stick and just a touch of power. Of course, a touch of power, that thing means you're getting something.
Yeah.
So I noticed that when I was doing steep turns too, Dave. You know, we can talk about control motions and all of this, or control response, but doing steep turns, you usually have to add a little power in an airplane because you bank it over 60 degrees. You lose enough lift. You got to add some power to keep the lift in. Oh, I goosed it a little, I gave it a little more like I would normally do it. Oh, we're climbing 500 feet a minute. That engine has got so much reserve of power that even way back in the 1500, 1600 RPM,
it's still
a little bit, it really yanks on you again. So from a power standpoint, it lacks nothing.
Yeah. Now, again, trying to fly the airplane straight and level, the attitude was a little bit nose down Yes. Like an old Cub would fly.
Right, the sight line.
Yeah.
I kept climbing.
Yeah. 150,
get that nose down there. There you go. Now you're flying. So yeah, almost feels like you're diving a shallow dive.
Yeah.
And that's level.
Yes. And again, one of the things that I like to do is I like to take the headsets off, because when you're on a long flight, the headsets in some cases get uncomfortable.
Yeah, sure.
You know, and so you want
it's
to
hot, take, you get a little sweaty and whatnot. Sweaty. So
I like pulling the headsets off and just seeing what kind of noise I've got there. And we've flown other aircraft composites and stuff like that. I mean, it's just like you being in your car at home, you know, you can sit there talking so forth.
A lot of the LSA, with especially with Rotax Power and all the silencers they use in Europe and whatnot, they're pretty quiet.
But this one here is not, you pull the headsets off and you know that you've got that big old Lycoming up front. It's the propeller, the noise, it is noise.
I didn't do that. Yeah. We had a little audio pickup inside the ear cup. So I didn't take it off at all because I didn't want to lose that. But so I didn't sense that. With the headphones off, of course, it's completely comfortable.
Yeah.
And he had some nice Bose active noise reduction headsets, and they work great.
Now, the other thing I did is I wanted to see, I mean, we were cold today, but I wanted to see what kind of airflow came through the cabin. He has four vents up on the roof.
Oh, yeah, right. I didn't play with those either because it was too cold today.
Well, he opened the vents, and believe me, there's a lot of airflow coming through those four vents. So we shut them down.
It's an interesting place for those kind of, it's the same kind you always see on the side of a cockpit.
Yeah.
They tilt in, and they twist and whatnot. But he had one up here, and I thought maybe that would bring in a lot of air.
There's actually four of them. There's two at the front and two at the back, if I remember rightly. Because I remember I opened the two up on my front, and he opened something up on the he has access to. And like I say,
you got a lot of air.
I got a lot of air. So then I asked about
the hot weather climates shouldn't be a problem. Plus, you can open.
Yeah, the doors.
He told me you can open one window or the other window, but
you
can't open both.
Yeah.
Says in the owner's manual, and he says his practice is open the window, and there's a nice latch out there, hold it nice and secure, big wide window, and then he puts the door down as well. You get a lot of airflow through.
Yeah. Great photo plane for that.
And we flew at what he said, you know, sometimes I just like to bring it down and fly like a Cub, and he means like an old-fashioned Cub.
Yeah.
So we did that, and I believe the number was that we brought it back to was, I kind of forgot the RPM now, but it was around 2,000 RPM, which is quite low. And then slowed it up to about 60 miles an hour, put a notch of flaps in, and all of a sudden it was. Just kind of like a whole... That big old engine was still rumbling up there, but the flight characteristics were very just old-fashioned Cub-like. Yeah. It was kind of fun.
Now, again, coming in for a landing, I had him do one for me, and then I set up for basically what he did so that I know what I was doing. And, of course, I come in high, ultralight background. Again, please, if you're watching this video, remember I'm an ultralight pilot from Canada. All I really fly is ultralights. So I'm coming in high and then talking to him. And, again, he's moving over to the side so that I can see the instruments. I indicate to him I don't want to see the instruments. I just want to see the way that it feels. And then I'll fly it the way that it feels. And that was not a problem. It does a nice side slip. I mean, I didn't do one where I'm dropping out of the sky, but you could feel the control. You fed in the rudder, you fed in the ailerons. It stayed as straight as you wanted to, or you could bring it back out. When you back the power down on it, though, it does come out of the sky.
It falls down out of the sky, yep. I noticed that as well. I had to add a little power on the approach to landing that I made because I put in flaps and backed off on the power too much, and by the time I did all of that, we were getting a little low, so I had to add a little, not much, and again, it doesn't take much of that thing, just a few hundred RPM, and everything leveled out and came in, but you're right.
And that's, again, what happened with
But that happens on all the Cubs.
Oh, yeah.
They're not any
slick. They're airplane.
Yeah, right.
No, they weren't ever designed to do that. They're just get in and out of a field, farmer's field.
They're closer to the ultralights that you and I both enjoy, so I have the same background as you. I said, well, I'm getting too low here. I'm not one of these guys that likes to skim it in low on approach. Maybe the jet jockeys can do that if they like, but
for me, I like to be high. Not like me. I don't like the numbers.
Nope. If the engine's going to quit, I don't want to come up short.
Yeah.
So I would rather have to figure out how to get it down than how to stretch my glide. I think you can't really do it.
And that's what happened with me. Is I'm coming in again, no flaps, because I want to see how the air performs with the side slip and all of this. And I'm coming in a little hotter than I would, and as I'm getting down to the 100-150 foot range, I drop the nose again because it's just that's what I've been doing all my life. Pick up that little extra speed, just
to make sure. Well, in a little gusty conditions, that's smart. And it was a little bit today, so.
And then we get down on the paved runway, and it floats. And remember, I have no flaps, so I'm not using flaps. So it floats and floats and
they
floats.
They get a pretty big wing on these airplanes.
And then it touches, and I, of course, relax. And as soon as I relax, it pops itself back up into the air.
Yeah, it wasn't quite done flying.
Yeah, so you just give it a little bit of a shot. And I did some video when we were at Midwest, and I just laughed at myself because I saw the Carbon Cub pilot come in. He just did that. He came in, he hit, and he bounced, and he saved it. And I said, how could, you know, come on now. And I just
now
realized,
you know, huh?
Now I know. These guys, even though you do it, you know, for a living, you do it time and time again. Every circumstance is different.
Well, and it's a floaty little airplane. That's the kind of airplane it is. Yeah. That's what's good about it, but it means that in that environment of landing, and these airplanes are relatively, the Cubs are actually a little bit heavier empty weight than some of the other LSA out on the market, but they're all light. Well, a light airplane, especially the cleaner it is, well, it wants to kind of float down the runway. Now, I didn't have that experience. I used one notch of flaps. I was going to use more, and I went, nah, I'm going to leave it just at one. And I ended up with a real nice touchdown, but I was in the front seat, so I had good instrumentation. I was watching the airspeed because I was trying to keep it right where it should be. And we approached at 60, about 55 over the beginning of the runway, and by the time I got into beginning my flare, I was probably down to 50. So I'm already pretty slow in the airplane. We're not hot anymore. Touchdown worked out really well. I thought it was an easy landing airplane. It's a tail dragger. Takeoff or landing, you better keep your feet moving. Now, boy, you better keep your feet moving. Yeah. Just a little bit. Constant series of little taps. And I noticed he asked both of us, you got tail dragger time?
Yeah.
He wanted to know what he was getting into.
He wanted to know whether I was an actual flight instructor, too. Yes, I am a flight instructor.
Well, you know, he agreed with this, too, because in his business of restoring old airplanes and getting them all spiffed up again for new buyers, he recognizes, too. I said, you know, pilot of many, master of none.
Yeah, but I was embarrassed. I mean, I am a tail dragger pilot. Probably 90% of my, you know, Sea Rays, my airplane, you know, you name it, I've flown it. And this airplane was different. The climb rate is something I have never experienced before.
That climb is something.
You know, I mean, I've flown on 582 Quicksilvers and in single place, and I don't have, you know, the power to weight ratio is.
You got it for a little while.
Yeah.
But this thing will just sort
constant.
Of just go up.
Yeah.
I mean, and continue going up. I won't say the Carbon Cub Super Sport has too much, but it's certainly got plenty.
If I was building an airplane, I'd want that power if I could get it.
Sure, well, I see the appeal.
You know, I would really love to have that power.
I mean,
I don't think
the number of times a wheel rotates before you're in the air is not very many.
Dan, I've got video of the airplane not turning a wheel. the gentleman.
You mean not all the way around once?
The gentleman that was flying it at Midwest, I think 2 years ago, he had the brakes on, he had the flaps down. He lifted the tail with the brakes on, and then
popped off.
He vertically took off.
Yeah. Well, a little bit of wind, evidently.
Well, yeah, there was a little.
Must have had some wind because obviously it wouldn't do that without any wind. Pretty impressive. In the stick forces, talked about doing some steep turns. First of all, I found generally the controls were nice. Mm-hmm. They were responsive. For me, the stick was, you know, maybe I could have adjusted the seat too. The stick was a little bit of a reach. That's picking, because it wasn't bad, but it was a little bit of a reach forward for me. But what I found was I did my old classic Dutch rolls, which is a maneuver where you attempt to hold this longitudinal axis of the airplane straight while rotating the wings about that axis. It takes normal control use of the coordinated use of the controls, but before it actually starts to turn, you go the other way so that you just keep it and go back and forth like this. I use this as an education for myself to feel how the controls work. If I can do that pretty quickly, then the controls are pretty intuitive. That's my general easy analysis. In the Cub, I was a little sloppy at first, and the reason why is because the rudders are a little more sensitive than the stick in roll. Pitch on the control was on the joystick was
positive.
Very, very positive. Very good. Not twitchy. Not too much. The trim is only on the front. You didn't experience that in the back. And the trim is on a lot of LSA. You just kind of want to tap it because the motor moves quickly. Mm-hmm. And if you hold on it, you're going to get more than you wanted. On this one, you basically hold it where you want it. Just when the pressure is relieved, then you let go. So in that sense, that was nice. But taking out pitch and just talking about roll pressures on the joystick and the coordination of that with the rudder pedals, The rudder pedals were a little light, joystick was a little heavy. Not a lot, it's not enough to complain about. But what it caused then on my Dutch rolls is I tended to wander a little bit. The nose, the airplane yawed a little bit because I was overusing the rudder pedals. When I relaxed the rudder pedals and just used the roll more, that worked. Now you said you had a similar experience when you did your roll into the turn. You tried it both ways. How'd that go?
I first tried the turn by applying aileron and then following it with rudder. And I found...
Which is kind of an old ultralight technique.
Yeah. You've always got adverse yaw. If you've got ailerons, use them. And then I asked, what was the gentleman's name we were flying with?
His name is Ben Redmond.
So I asked Ben, I said, Ben, how do you, do you start with rudder and then add aileron, or do you add aileron and rudder together? He indicated, no, start with rudder and then feed aileron. I tried that. It didn't feel as comfortable.
That was his technique, yeah.
Yeah, it didn't feel as comfortable for me as it would with aileron and then with the rudder. But again, you and I fly these things for 15 or 20 minutes, Dan. These people fly them for like...
Well, you had a 3.5-hour trip down here from Faribault, Minnesota, so that alone, more time than I'll probably ever have in a car would go right there.
I mean, the coordinated turns that he did compared to what I did, I mean, there was no comparison. I mean, it was like I was a student and he was the instructor.
Sure, well, that's about the fact of it, actually. Yeah. So, yeah.
So, overall, this is a great performing little airplane. And it will get in and out of anywhere, especially with those big tires.
The backwoods guys must love this thing. Right. Who wouldn't love this? Yeah. But especially if you're taxing it that way and trying to say, hey, here's my runway. I got to get out of here. No problem.
And I really think this airplane would make a great float plane. I mean, again, I'm a float plane pilot.
Sure. Well, all that power, again, is going to work very well on a float plane.
And a light airplane with a big wing. I mean, it's just got to be a fantastic float plane. That'd be great to fly one on floats. But the quality of the workmanship of this airplane, Dan, is the best that I think I've seen in the industry for this type of airplane.
Very, very nice.
The finish of the airplane, interior and exterior-wise, the layout of the instrument panel and stuff, again, I mean, it's...
Not only is it nice, Dave, but it's a little artistic, the way they've done stuff. I mean, it's more than just nicely done, like a BMW is, or, some high-end car looks nice, but this has also got a little style to it that's, which makes it sort of not Cub-like. Your basic J3 Cub was a pretty Spartan airplane.
Yeah.
And this is not Spartan. It doesn't cost like a Spartan airplane, but it doesn't look like one either. It's got a lot of finish.
It doesn't perform well. I mean, you're not ever going to get a Cub, even a Super Cub, to do what this thing does. I mean, this, with a half power, will outperform anything I have flown to date.
Yeah, it was spectacular. That was fun. Man, he said smoothly had the power to full throttle. Well, shortly after you get that thing to the forward stop, you better be ready to fly because it's ready to fly. So very exciting. Very nice job by Cub Crafters. The downsides, I guess, are it costs like a very well-finished airplane. But if it's in your budget, you get a lot of airplane for the money and you get all the performance. I don't know how you could ask for much more.
They make other aircraft.
They do. They make a simpler version without that engine, and that is undoubtedly at a much better price point. And they do restorations on other airplanes, too. I know that company has really cut their teeth on doing restorers.
And I think if you look at the numbers, they're pretty well up there in the sales factors.
They've done very well.
Crafted or sold.
Looks like Cub Crafters on sort of a steady pace, just about like their airplane.
Just the way that it climbs out. The
airplane's climbing, the company's climbing. Good job, Cub Crafters.
Okay. So I guess that's it. We've got a couple more that we're supposed to do if the weather will let us.
Let's go do it.
Okay.
All right.